Hi, everybody. My name is Brendan Smith. I'm the arts coordinator for the City of Takoma Park, and I wanted to welcome you all out on a snowy night. This event is part of our We Are Takoma art series. We do all kinds of different programming, including music. You might have seen the art exhibition out here in the lobby. Poetry, film. If you want to know more about our upcoming events, you can go to takomaparkmd.gov/arts. So I'd like to welcome back to our stage Ronn McFarlane. He's a Grammy-nominated lutenist who's played all over the world and played here previously. And he previously was a faculty member at the Peabody Conservatory for more than a decade. And he's formed an ensemble called Earhart to play traditional music on the lute, a very popular instrument back during the Renaissance that's making a resurgence now, in part because of Ronn. So thank you very much. And actually, afterwards, he's going to be out in the lobby signing CDs if you want to stop by there. And if you didn't see the donation box, then you can stuff that with bills on your way out. We like keeping all our events free, but we also want to support our performers. So without further ado, I give you Ronn.
Those of you watching at home on TV or live streamed, I hope you're snug and warm at home while you're watching this. I'd like to start with a very old tune that was published in 1508. In fact, the whole idea of music publishing was just getting going at that time. So this is a dance, an Italian dance called a piva, and this is by an old composer named Joan Ambrosio Dalza. By a Frenchman. A Frenchman next. This is by Adrien Leroy, and it's a dance called Pasimes. A dance called a Pasimes. Sorry, need to speak into the microphone. I'll remember that in the future, hopefully. So this dance was so popular So cool, in fact, that the author, Anne Rice, mentions it in one of her books. I think her character is playing this particular piece. She mentions it. And the character is a sort of secret agent, assassin, time traveler who plays the lute. So I have one out of those four things in common with the character. Characters are always much cooler than any life I've seen nearby. But at any rate, the character zooms back to the Renaissance and is playing this tune in a tavern at the end of Anne Rice's book. So here it is. This is a Pazimez by Adrian Lewa. Thank you. So I'm going to switch lutes now. I think I could feel some of you counting the strings on my lute out there. This has 19 strings. It's arranged into 10 courses. And this is the latest model, the 18th century model for the lute. This has 24 strings. arranged into 13 courses. So I have a couple of single strings, and then it's all in pairs after that, two unison or octave pairs. So you always play two strings together as if they're just one string. I'm just going to play a couple of Irish tunes next. The first one is called Carillon's Welcome, and this is by Turlough O'Carillon, the famous Irish composer. He was born in 1670, lived until 1738, and he's kind of regarded as Ireland's national composer, a harp player, and just a brilliant melody writer. So here's Carillon's Welcome. I'm going to follow that up with a jig called Banish Misfortune. Now over to Scotland for a piece called Harlaw Brasnachad. At least that's as close as I can come to pronouncing it. Harlaw, it was a battle that was fought in 1411 in Scotland, really a terrible bloody battle, but it at least resulted in this beautiful tune in memory of all those lost at the battle. I'm going to follow that with two Irish jigs called Pipe on the Hob and The Cliffs of Moher, and then two slip jigs called Hey My Nanny and Guzzle Together. Those two are Scottish. Thank you. So the Lute has a huge amount of music from the 16th, 17th, and 18th centuries. Actually, more than 40,000 pieces. It's really a huge repertory. So it makes no sense for me to be writing even more for it. But here we go anyway. Here's an original tune for the Lute. This is called Cathedral Cave, and it's a kind of a tone poem for the real Cathedral Cave, which is at the bottom of the ocean beneath the Tasman Sea. Thank you. another original tune, somewhat inspired by Celtic music, my Scottish and Irish tunes. This one is called Indigo Road. Catch my breath after that one. I have a couple of tunes I wanted to tell you about. The first one is called Denali, and that is it's really inspired by a trip I took to Alaska some years back. I was blessed to be able to go play there a couple of times, and Denali, the highest mountain in North America, is just absolutely regal and majestic. But also I was surprised at how gentle much of the land was in the Denali region nearby. And this piece tries to encapsulate both sides of the character, both the sort of hard, uncompromising nature and also the rather soft and lush side of the land there. I'm going to follow that with a piece called Overland. And that also comes from an experience, a tour that I took with the Baltimore Consort some years back. And we flew out to Montana and drove through Montana, Wyoming, to New Mexico, doing concerts all along the way. And I don't know that this is still the case, but at that time, on some of these long straightaway stretches of road, there was no speed limit. In fact, the speed limit signs beside the road would say, speed limit prudent and reasonable, nighttime 80. So the fastest driver in the group got behind the wheel. We're going pretty fast. We're up into the triple digits, 105, 110, 115. I'm relegated to the back seat. My palms are getting a little bit cold and sweaty. I'm not used to going nearly that fast. But I'm looking out the window at the Rocky Mountains. We're in a huge valley at the time, and the Rockies are so huge that we barely seemed to be moving compared with how big the mountain was just beside us. And literally, as I was looking out the window, the tune for this came into my head. And I've always associated it with that moment because the tune, especially later in the piece, is kind of slow and expansive. And at the same time, there's a kind of motor, a kind of propulsive musical engine that keeps running the piece, keeps it going throughout. So that's Overland. And then a third one, I'm going to do three in a row. Third one is called Pine Tops. And Pine Tops was written in Houston in July. And quite different from from today, Houston really has a special kind of hot in July. And I wrote it during that time. So hope you enjoy these three. Thank you. A little bit of weather music for you next. This one is called Blue Norther. Thank you. Well, I used to live in Austin, Texas for a while, and when I was there, my wife and I knew a couple named Carlos and Rosa. They were good friends of our son as well, and I wrote this piece. They kind of symbolized for me a really vibrant Hispanic culture there in Austin. And so I wrote this piece in that sort of style and was going to name it Carlos y Rosa. And I had the piece written, named, all ready to go, and then Carlos and Rosa broke up. Sad. And I somehow didn't think I could keep the name in the piece if they weren't together in real life. So I'm sorry, Carlos, but Rosa has a more poetic sounding name. So this is called Rosa. Nothing against Carlos now. Thank you. Thank you. So I'm going to play three pieces to end the evening. These are three originals. The first one is called Over the Green Earth. It's kind of a Celtic style tune. I'm going to follow that with Augusta, which is a... It was written in Augusta, Georgia. That's really the only reason it's called Augusta. But it's kind of a nostalgic, almost regretful sounding piece. In fact, I dug up the original piece of music that I wrote it on, and it says to play it regretfully. I didn't remember that. I wonder what I was thinking back then. At any rate, I'm going to follow that finally with a piece called Gig, and it's kind of inspired by sort of 17th century style dances. It's just sort of a normal, sort of jovial kind of dance that would end a suite. So thanks so much for coming out. And if you have any questions about the lute, I just want to give you fair warning because I can completely nerd out on you if you have any questions. I've been known to follow people out to the parking lot to try to finish explaining what I need to explain about the lute as they roll up their windows. There's just one more thing. So fair warning, happy to talk about the lute. And thanks so much for coming. Thank you.
Thank you.